This is Strange Love, After Hours. I'm your host, Cami Chaos. Welcome, babies. Good evening, and welcome to a very Halloween episode of Strange Love Live After Hours. I'm your host, Cami Chaos, and this week I'm joined by my little pet Ruby. And also by a... Whoa, that's not Dr. Normal. Hello? Do you speak a human language?
Yeah, sure. Of course I do. Hang on.
What are you doing in my... That's my husband's chair.
Oh, yeah. Hi. Hi, everybody. I'm Snork from Ork. And Dr. Normal has the night off tonight. And
I didn't even notice earlier. Were you here during the... During the tech edition?
Yeah.
Maybe I should look up every once in a while.
Yeah. So, Dr. Normal took the night off, and I'm here. I'm the only guy around who could run the TriCaster right now. I'm just in from the mothership. So, so here I am, and, you know, running the TriCaster, having a good time. I wore my Halloween costume tonight.
What are you dressed as? Snork? Is it Snork?
Snork.
What are you dressed as?
Snork from Ork. Well, I'm dressed as a cubicle, earthling cubicle dweller.
Ah.
Yeah. Since I came down on the mothership, I've been doing a little moonlighting and doing tech support. You know. Yeah. I mean, I can handle your MS-DOS. I flew in on the mothership, for God's sake. I mean, come on.
That's fair.
You know, I can type a few, you know, commands and, you know, whatnot.
How are you finding Portland?
I use the Google Maps. I use the Google with my iPhone.
Not how are you finding it on the map. How are you finding your experience of Portland? Are you enjoying Portland, Snork?
You know, I'll tell you what. What I have to figure out is how to switch this this doggone thing with my big purple eyes.
I could show you.
These purple eyes work great in space, but not too well running the TriCaster doing your show. But yeah, I use the the Google Maps, and I'm the mayor of I believe I'm the mayor of Whiffy's now.
What's your favorite pie flavor?
You know, they're doing a pumpkin pie with chocolate chips, and I'm looking forward to that. I think that'll be a big hit.
Mm.
Yeah. Makes so, you know, I'm just here and hanging out. And
should I be concerned? I mean, are you like a cattle prod, anal probe kind of alien, or are you just chilling?
You know, we got a really bad rap on that cattle prod, anal probe kind of thing. You know, that's a small minority of us aliens that I mean, quite frankly,
you're not answering my question. Should I be worried?
No, I'm cool, man. The majority of aliens are just coming down off the mothership, hanging out, doing a little tech support, going to food carts. You know, there's some nice bars, and there's always stuff going on in Portland. There's every day. There's concerts, cultural events. I love First Thursday. I love the Pearl. You know, so there's just stuff going on. These anal probe, you know, twisted aliens. This is the bad. These are the bad echelon. The bad minority. They give us all a bad name.
Okay.
You know. I mean, it's like if you sent... It's like if you sent, you took one of your spaceships, right? You sent it to another planet, and you filled it full of a bunch of shock jack DJs.
I know the type.
Yeah, and that would really suck.
It would.
It would reflect poorly on Earth.
So that's Snork, what it's like. Snork, we probably really should introduce our guest, but I have a question for you first. Is Dr. Normal coming back
Hurry up
later?
Because I'm suffocating.
Oh, you can't breathe our earth air. I understand. Is Dr. Normal coming back later, or are you going to be in my bed later as well? I'm just saying. Because usually after the show, you know, the doctor and I, we go upstairs.
Well, hey, baby, do you swing that way? I mean, do you swing alien?
I don't know.
Extraterrestrial?
I'm not sure what's in the alien pants.
You know, I mean, I'm telling you.
Let's discuss this later, Mr. Snork, and introduce our guest for the evening.
Oh, geez. Leave it to Cammy Chaos to
hit on an alien.
Drive this bit into the ground. I have been watching your show. We do get it back on the home planet. We love it. We love it.
We're popular there? On Ork?
Yeah.
Snork. Yeah. All right. Well, do you mind if I talk to our guest now?
Yes, by all means.
Back from the Tech Edition, we have Jemiah Jefferson.
Mm-hmm.
How many shows have you been on with an alien?
Not so many. Mm-hmm. I know my recall isn't all that crystal clear, but because, you know, the anal probe thing, they also had the flashy thing. And, you know,
the men in black,
I kind of remember the flashy thing.
Yeah.
The anal probe, I don't have a very good recollection of that, but I think I was into it. I don't know.
Yeah.
Surprisingly, I was surprisingly not anti.
I think the larger question is how many shows are you on that talk about your books in a very serious way and then start later with a guy in a rubber mask?
That'd be none, Bob. That would be my first time. My very first time.
Yay!
Yeah, it's special. You were here for it.
Mm. All right, we had this whole list of things that we need to discuss during After Hours. I'm going to let
you... Yeah, where was that? What were we talking about?
Do you remember any of them? Do you want to pick one? Do you want me to throw some stuff out there? We could discuss that Jimmy has never been to Whiffy's.
Yeah, I've never been to Whiffy's, and I love pie.
Mm-hmm.
And I love food carts.
Greg serves
and
up some
I have been missing out on the food cart phenomena,
mm-hmm.
and it drives me nuts because I like food.
I like food.
And I like street food, and I like standing food. There and devouring something before
some really
it falls apart.
Great street food in Portland. We've done entire episodes dedicated to food carts.
You were telling me about that gyro. It's the size of, like, a planet.
I was?
Was it you?
No.
It wasn't you?
Me, but
there
that
was somebody
sounds
else
really
that,
tasty.
One of the food carts that's over by PSU, they have gyros that are, like, this big.
Is it food
and
carts?
I was like, dude.
Is it food carts Portland or I always put it in the wrong order, Mike. Is it food carts Portland, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so go to foodcartsportland.com.
Okay. All right.
And Diesel Boy is putting some fine material up there on food carts of all natures. We had him on the show to talk just about that.
Good, because I need to experience the gyro that's mm-hmm. the size of a cat.
Mm-hmm.
But unfortunately, you know, their hours are mostly, you know, weekdays when, you know, I'm over in Milwaukee at my job.
Yeah.
But apparently they are open on Saturday.
You know, the Whiffies that I was talking about as well, there is mm-hmm. the whole pod out there on Hawthorne. And they're like the late night pod.
Yeah. So you can get the, you know, your pommes frites mm-hmm. and crepes, mm-hmm. I believe.
They have
also.
Crepes and they have the potato and, champion. And what's the one that has the jambalaya?
Oh, Lord.
I don't know. They've
no, I need to actually, like, set aside, like, an evening.
A food cart night.
Yeah, to just go there specifically to eat at the carts. Mm-hmm. And I'm thinking that might be a really good cold, but not rainy, Saturday night kind of fun.
Yeah.
But it needs to be scheduled. Plus,
and there was always, like, there's always, like, an interesting collection of people there to observe.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
So,
and, you
it's
know,
fun.
You might be able to mess with their heads a little bit. That's part of the fun.
Or they'll try to mess with yours.
They always do.
This is Portland, after all.
They always do. It's all hard. Right. It's hard.
We've got talking to do.
We're going to talk about TV, I know.
Yeah. Let's start with the, you know, what have you been doing for the last, I'm guessing, 12 to 14
Oh, man,
years.
So much. so very much. Must have been unpleasant.
Yeah. Just
I've had like a gloss. Billion jobs.
Yeah. But you like the job you have now.
But I like the job I have now because it's awesome and ridiculously great.
Can you say where you're working now?
I work at Dark Horse Comics.
You're so lucky. In
the editorial department, where I can use all my editorial skills to make the world a better place and make sure that those books have a better chance of getting done on time, making everybody happy, highest possible quality we can do. And yeah. I love the people who are there. I love my coworkers. I love the fact that I have an office with a door that closes.
Oh my God, no. And surely not in this day and age, a door.
I know.
It closes?
It closes. And I can put up, you know, that we are honor bound to decorate our offices. Mm-hmm. And so to the left of me, you know, I have my desk here and the computer monitor here. To the left of me, I have what is called the Wall of Hotties, where all of the, you know, sort of like pinups and general images or whatever that I've run across, I have, you know, pretty much starting from the ceiling top of the cubicle to, you know, eye level, all the ones that make me go, oh my God.
I see there.
Yeah. Yeah, that's the Doctor action figure. That's special.
It came from the Doctor Who Museum in Wales.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, can I see him pretty little trainers? Is he wearing, like, Vans? I don't know. I guess they're supposed to be Chucks, but...
Mm-hmm. They don't look like Chucks.
No, he shouldn't be wearing white Chucks, though. It's not really very Doctor-y.
You know the other thing that's a little disappointing?
He's a cobalt blue Chucks kind of guy.
If you look under his coat, which
of course
I'm
you
sure you
to.
Would, you will notice that the back of his suit jacket...
Mm-hmm.
It's not pinstriped.
Oh, what a cheat.
Sorry.
Now, what I need to know is, do they have the equivalent Captain Jack action figure so you can make naughty love?
Holly, can you look into that for me? Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Yeah.
Holly's the one that sent him to me.
Oh, yeah.
She lives just a couple miles away from the Doctor Who Museum.
I watched, I had the swine flu in the summertime, and so I watched Torchwood Children of Earth. And
oh girl.
And the thing I love about watching Torchwood. Oh, I cried like a baby and was just like, oh God. I love Torchwood because I love Gwen.
Mm-hmm.
And unfortunately, I'm also a Margaret Cho fan. Mm-hmm. So whenever I'm watching the show, whenever they, you know, Gwen comes on screen, I'm just like, it's Gwen. She's here to wash your vagina. And then I giggle and I miss, you know, important plot points. And then I have to watch
then
it again.
Rewind.
And then I just rewind it and I'm just like, oh Gwen, you're so fabulous. I love you. I love you, Torchwood.
I love Torchwood. Torchwood is good.
But yeah, Children of Earth was a whole nother level of awesome.
It was hard to giggle at things while watching.
I just couldn't believe that they would introduce moral dilemmas that thorny on what's supposed to be a children's show. I mean, Torchwood isn't really a children's show, but you know, it's a
spinoff of what's supposed to be a children's
show.
It's
the grown-up children's show, but you know, it's Torchwood. It's a little bit frothy, and you know, they're a little bit ditzy, and you know, a little bit unfocused. But Children of Earth was just like
Children of Earth.
Hey,
do not
what are
let
you
your
willing
child
to do
in a house with you while you watch that?
Yeah, no, because
that is some seriously messed up. Woohoo!
Yeah.
And totally worth watching.
Moral dilemma of just like, what are people in power asked to do to save lives? And these are, you know, the kinds of decisions that they may well have to make. And they're gonna do it, and they're gonna be able, and they're gonna have to live with it. And watching them just break down further and further and further, and watching the morality get darker and darker and darker and darker.
There's no right answer.
No, there's
except
no,
for
there
to
was,
never
was
started
no,
anything in the first place.
Exactly. Not that they had any choice.
No, I think we need to move on to a brighter but strange subject.
Yes.
You've never seen Angel except for the first six
no,
episodes.
No, I've seen the first six episodes of Angel and was just like, yeah! Loved them.
Never.
What's his name? The Psychic Surgeon episode was the bomb! That was fantastic!
Uh-huh.
You know, that's the kind of TV I like to watch. Mm-hmm.
And it's gone now, of course.
Mm-hmm.
But
you know, and I was trying to watch it on Hulu, but they, you know, I had episodes queued up and, you know, I'd finished and, watched a couple of episodes and then was like, okay, I'm going to get back to this. Then watched a bunch of other stuff on Hulu because I like to watch, I like to do my Heroes rewatch Tuesday, Wednesday, or whatever on Hulu. And I like to watch Dollhouse on Hulu just to, you know, partially just to give them ratings, but also because I like to watch Dollhouse episodes multiple times. Mm-hmm. And so then when I was just like, all right, you know, it's like 9 o'clock on a, you know, on a Tuesday night or whatever, or Monday night, I'm going to watch another Angel episode. And so I go to look at my queue and it's just like, this episode is no longer available. I'm like, what? It was fine a month ago. Where'd it go? Sad. So, you know, if you have Angel and you can help me out, please, please do. Because the library copies, I don't know what people be doing with them, but they're cleaning them with steel wool.
They gave them to Ruby. She got hungry.
Yeah. And you're not even supposed to be poisonous. You're just supposed to hug people to death.
She likes to nibble on things.
Yeah.
She's teething. Poor little Ruby.
She's always teething, though.
I know, because they constantly lose their teeth.
They shed those. Did you happen to see the picture of the shark that was bitten in half by the other shark?
No.
Dude, it was amazing. One of my coworkers, again, Dark Horse Culture, was just like, come over here and look at this. And there's like, and it was in the Daily Mail, on the Daily Mail website. The Daily Mail, it's an awful place. Horrible, horrible newspaper filled with ugly, horrible people. But they had this photograph of a shark being, you know, pulled out of the ocean because he'd been caught on a net line or something.
Are you looking for this Dr. Normal?
Yeah, it's horrifying. And, you know,
excuse me.
There was just like this huge bite mark missing out of the side of this 15-foot shark. And
was the shark that bit him bigger?
It would have had to be. And they're just like, okay, so judging by the size of the jaws here, that shark is probably about 25 to 28 feet in length, which is, you know, around the same size as, you know, the Jaws shark, except for that's fiction. Yeah. Sharks don't actually, not actually that big, but I guess they're getting to be that big and they will just bite other sharks in half.
When I was a kid, was great. We had a swimming pool. And I never saw the movie Jaws.
Mm-hmm. I've never seen it either. I'm desperate to see it.
Really?
I love Roy Scheider, so hell yeah, I'm down with that.
I like the horror-themed books, and I like psychological horror movies. Mm-hmm. But aside from the really campy stuff, like Bruce Campbell stuff, I'm not a big horror fan.
It's not really a horror movie. It's a thriller.
God.
And apparently it is structured in a completely genius fashion.
I can't.
The script is brilliant. The performances are brilliant.
Because...
And there's, you know, nothing. It's suggestion.
When I was a kid,
that's all.
I was convinced that there was a shark living in my pool. And I could not swim in it unless someone had gotten into the pool before me. And usually it was my brother because I didn't care.
And combed it with a net.
I did not care if my brother got eaten by the shark.
Well, no.
It didn't matter that I could see in the pool. There was a shark in the pool somewhere.
Mm-hmm. He was hiding.
Didn't matter that the chlorine would probably have killed it. Or that it would have been such a little
chlorine
shark that I would have been able
real.
To kill it.
That's a pleasant fiction that parents tell kids that so that they know that there's no sharks in the pool.
Yeah.
There are.
No, there was a shark
there
in my
are.
Pool.
There are
I sharks. Almost got bit by a snake in my pool once, though.
What?
I lived in Texas.
Oh, anything could happen.
Yeah,
there.
Yeah. No,
Florida
we always
too.
Had snakes. Snakes, pigs, and dogs always jumping in our pool.
He had really good cleaning chemicals.
But yeah, I remember the chemical smell coming off my, like, burning my flesh as I got out of the pool.
Yeah.
I wasn't worried about the sharks in Texas, though. Because I was too busy worrying about the giant...
You were in the wrong part of
it. It wasn't even a pig. It was a boar. I was too busy worrying about the boar and the snake that almost bit me.
Boars.
Yeah. Big, bristly, mean... One of them cornered me up a tree.
I guess they're good eating, though.
Yeah, they are.
Someday.
Oh, look. Dr. Normal has pulled up.
Yeah, I wanted to talk about the newest book.
A Drop of Scarlet. I would like to note that if you're interested in Jemiah's books, you can go to her website, and there's a link to go buy them.
On Amazon.
On Amazon.
Oh, and I'm going to set up my my Amazon Author Central page very soon.
Nice.
So that will be a new feature that will be live and available probably starting next week, because I need to put... photograph and bio up on there, but that's, I guess, a new program that Amazon is doing that pretty much anybody who has a book can now basically make this sort of like micro site as an author to be able to better promote the book. And then you can either blog on that site, or you can RSS from a blog that you already have, so that, you know, there's an actual like author blog there, and there's a message board for each author. And so whenever you look up the author and you go to their Author Central, it will bring up all of their books.
That's fantastic.
And yeah, they've needed that for really a while. Neat.
Because I hate that when you type in the it's always been very convoluted.
Yeah, like it's that. A drag. But so that will be a new thing. That's and fantastic. So I'm gonna work that up a little bit this weekend. And you know, and ideally people will actually go buy the books. And I guess that A Drop of Scarlet is available in Kindle format.
Oh, very nice.
Which I totally didn't know. Until very recently. Yeah, I was just like, what? Because I, you know, I was
with the Kindle?
Yeah, I was looking up me on Amazon for some particular purpose. Yeah, I have to, you know, go looking for my books every once in a while.
Vanity search yourself. It's good
and,
for you.
And, you know, it's like, okay, A Drop of Scarlet, you know, looking for the release date. And it's just like available for Kindle. And I was like, oh,
nice.
Fresh.
Very nice.
So I'm hoping that people read that. And also, A Drop of Scarlet is so special because it is set in Portland.
Now, can people read these books independent of one another?
Absolutely. They all stand on their own. But if you read them, in the order that they came out, they sort of inform each other and explain and sort of like richen the experience. Mm-hmm. And if you read them in the chronological order of the events that happen, which would be Fiend, Voice of the Blood, Wounds, A Drop of Scarlet, then you get, you know, basically the sort of like chronological, you know, history of all of the characters that are in it. But A Drop of Scarlet is set almost entirely in Portland, Oregon, complete with various landmarks. There are certain clubs that I specifically talk about.
Nice.
The bar that is now the East End. There's a scene that's set there that I think is really hilarious and, you know, basically set in the hallway in front of the bathroom where Walt Curtis lives. And, yeah, I had to do that. And also at, well, I don't even know what it's called now. The sort of, like, dancey ballroom that's on 7th and Eastburn side.
Dancy ballroom on 7th.
Yeah, and then you go upstairs, and there's, you know, a really fabulous billiards hall and kind of a performance space. And there was, you know, it used to be kind of like a dance club type thing there. And now I guess it's like a country western dance club.
Country western dance club.
Or something like that. But for a while, it was really gothy.
It's amazing the variety of different dance clubs that Portland can contain.
This is very true.
From like goth clubs, punk clubs, like swing dance, country western. We've got everything.
Yeah. I wish there were places that I could go to listen to the country music that I like. It's kind of rare.
Do you like the old style country music?
I like the old stuff, and I like the newer stuff that's informed specifically by that.
Yeah, I like the old country music, but I refuse to listen to
anything
new.
The newer stuff is like, you should listen to the Dixie Chicks, though.
I make the exception to the Dixie Chicks.
Because they're all about Dolly Parton, and...
Except I don't like Kenny Rogers.
That's okay.
Which is important.
That's okay.
It's mostly because I wrote a blog post about that this week.
Yeah.
My mother and her sister ruined me by making me go. My first concert ever was a Kenny Rogers concert, and my aunt threw her panties at the stage.
I've thrown panties.
At Kenny Rogers?
Panties, no, not at Kenny Rogers. I threw my panties at John Spencer, and he did not pick them up. And then later, when Boss Hogg came to town, I threw the exact same pair of panties at him, and he was like,
"Because you picked them back up."
He didn't pick them up, but Christina, his wife, picked them up and saw me, and she's just like, "Ed," I'm just like, "Sweet."
Aww,
and she was
good.
Down. And then John Spencer tried to kill me with the neck of his guitar.
That's something that you can be proud of.
You need to chill out. I'm having fun with you. I bought that pair. It had the tags on it. Come on.
It was specifically, I don't think my aunt's panties had tags.
Tags still on.
I don't think.
They were brand new.
I don't think my aunt's undies had tags. I just don't think they did.
They were just the, like, you know, the Luther Vandross, you know, shimmy out of them.
Scarred.
And, yeah.
I need to find a concert that I can go to that I can throw my.
Throw your panties.
My man panties.
Your manties. They're called manties.
I've got some that I can actually get rid of.
That will be
holes in them and stuff.
Or peaches. totally peaches. Throw
if
your
you
underwear
If you
want to
throw the
peaches.
Holy, holy
What's
bad
peaches?
Ones.
Peaches?
You know about peaches?
No, I don't know anything.
Oh, goodness. Peaches is wonderful.
I don't know.
Yeah, I don't
know. But if you want to throw the holy panties, you should throw them at someone you don't like. You shouldn't
right.
throw, like, ugly,
anything
holy
modern
under.
Would work for me.
Okay.
Oh, you're one of those people, Doctor.
Yeah.
He's
I see.
He's an old musician, he doesn't like anything new.
There's that really good band that Robert Wagner kind of featured, that Target for Tomorrow, which is a local Portland band, and they're up in iTunes now, and they're, like, $4 for their album, and I'm going to get that. They're kind of like...
Yeah, tell me.
They're... Totally, some of their stuff sounds like the horn band ska of the Crazy Eights, but other stuff is like porn funk and stuff. It's
sold.
Yeah, yeah, it's good stuff.
I like the porn funk.
Yeah, well,
yeah.
What do you think I write? You know, if I ever have time to make music, it sounds like porn funk.
Right? Thank you.
Your dad, I made a video once with the family, and I put a That's tune decent. Of mine on, and your dad said, could you please remove the porn music from the family video?
Yeah.
That's what your dad said.
Yeah. He was right, though.
See, my dad would be like, nice.
That was like, no, it was like super porn music family thing. Mm-hmm. He's made more appropriate music choices in his life.
That's good.
And sometimes not.
And sometimes not so much.
Maybe next year, 2010, will be the Dr. Normal...
The review.
Year of,
excuse me.
You know, the music. We've got a lot of stuff. I've still got a CD in the can.
I have to ask her a very
release.
Important question that came
Please
to mind
do.
When she was talking about the author page.
Mm-hmm.
My least favorite thing, I like to write. I love to write. It makes me very happy.
Yes.
But my least favorite thing ever in the history of the world to write is a bio of myself.
Mm-hmm. I hate it.
How do you
hate
handle
it? Like poison. Just keep revising the bio that I wrote when I was in like 1998.
I just
gently tweak it now and again.
I can't handle a bio.
It's awful, and I can't handle a five word bio.
I can't handle 500. I can't handle a bio.
I have to do it all the time, and it's very painful, and it always looks wrong. And I look at other people's bios, and I'm just like, oh god.
And you can't copy their bio.
Wrong.
You can't copy someone else's bio. I've thought about it. I'm like, why don't I just take that? And
yeah,
then they
exactly.
won't know it's
and just
not
change
me.
The
it has nothing to do with me, but
yeah, but the details are really different, and you know,
yeah.
I just don't know what to mention.
Exactly, I never know what to include.
I'm
like, I'm
just like, well, I wrote these books, and I finally have, and I feel sad about this. I have finally taken the fact that I went to Reed College off of my author bio because that's not actually relevant.
You're a grown up now.
I know, but I went to Reed College. Somebody needs to know and care about that.
I know that you went to Reed
I went
Reed
through
College.
Hell, and I want people to know. I'm a survivor. I went to Reed College.
I'm so proud of you that because I made a promise, I am going to throw this bat at you. It's the Halloween episode.
Oh, I'm just
going to
throw a bat right back at you.
Oh, thank you.
Ah, they're everywhere.
Oh, let's get Dr. Normal.
Dr. N, no. They're really just like, they're like throwing
little,
stars.
Yeah, they're like little bat
shuriken.
Ninja weapons.
Yeah. But now, you know,
and
since I don't have the
pop culture and throwing stars, did you ever see the television show of the Green Hornet?
No.
With Bruce Lee as
no.
Kato?
I know.
With the throwing?
No, I've never seen it.
It was awesome.
No.
I grew up on that.
It was
that
really
killed.
Awesome.
It's because I'm younger than you.
And they had to take it off TV because it was too violent for the kiddies. Because it was Bruce Lee.
I love Bruce
and
Lee.
And Van.
But.
I can't remember that guy's name.
Some guy with the name.
And now they're redoing it with some other
I don't
want to
talk
guy.
About the redoing
yeah,
of things.
Yeah, it's not. I did see the car at Comic-Con. Oh, man.
Yeah.
It's the hotness.
Yeah.
It was right there. You know, and you know, it's that car. You
that would
know,
be
like,
the Black Beauty.
That would be the Black Beauty. And so they only made two of them, and one of them was actually like on set being like, you know, lit and stuff so they could figure out how reflective the paint job and everything was. So they had the other one, the like really good sort of like showroom model on the floor at Comic-Con, and everybody else is, you know, kind of running off and being like, oh, it's
like,
Elizabeth Mitchell from Lost.
Oh,
I have to get her autograph. And I'm just
beauty.
Like, this car is fabulous. It's just beautiful. So I just wanted to touch it. It's just a gorgeous thing. Yeah, they don't really care for that, unless it was the hero's booth, in which case you're supposed to get in the car. They had two Nissan Cubes at the Heroes booth at Comic-Con. Yeah, you were supposed to actually get in the car.
There's not like a special, like amazing. It's not like a James Bond car.
No, I guess it was pretty cool inside though.
You didn't get in.
No, there's I'll too show many you people the car. There.
Cars That's on IMDb.
Is it?
Yeah, I saw pictures of it.
The baby or the cube?
Yeah, no, there's the car.
He doesn't do the Heroes.
Oh yeah, right on.
The TV.
That's okay.
Is that the guy who's playing the Green Hornet? Is he from Heroes?
No.
No.
I don't know who.
No, actually, you really like one of the guys from Heroes.
Seth Rogen is going to be the Green Hornet.
I don't think
Spock. Spock was from Heroes.
This is the car from the movie. This will be the
beautiful.
Look at that. I hope the movie is
good. Look at that. Look just.
What's the black
boot? It's going to be awesome, actually. I'm really. I was annoyed when I heard about the fact that they were doing that film, but after seeing the car and knowing who is making the movie, I'm just like, no, it's going to be great.
Yeah.
It's going to be good fun. They're not going to take it too seriously, but they're going to take it just seriously enough.
Who's playing Kato?
I can't remember. It's somebody awesome.
Doc is playing Kato.
I'm looking forward.
Yeah, it's somebody that I'm just like, yeah.
Well, that's the way I felt about the guy. I mean, the guy who plays Green Hornet, I don't know.
Seth Rogen?
Yeah, I don't know.
I think he's going to be very funny, but I'm just like,
I don't want the Green Hornet to be funny. The Green Hornet was the one guy who just walked into a room. He's a great
straight man, too. He doesn't actually have to do anything. No. He just stands there and is sad.
But the important thing about the Green Hornet is pretty much you don't want the Green Hornet and Kato to show up in your apartment because you're an evildoer.
That's true.
I mean, literally, there's major ass-kicking that happens when the Green Hornet... It's not Batman. It's not anything. It's pretty much you will be beaten to an inch of your life.
I need to ask her an important question, but you're not going to want to listen.
Well, no. I want
to...
No,
he's going to get to work looking up names for us on the end of the...
Well, here... No.
This is serious, though, and we're running out of time, and I really need to consult her.
She's a comic...
I really need to consult her about something that you're not going to want to listen to. Consulting
about the Green Hornet, the only goddamn
that's true.
Superhero I like.
Okay, that's not true.
Okay, here
that's
it is.
That's a lie. You like other superheroes.
No. Well, I like... Okay. Well, Seth Batman. Rogen,
you like the ones that aren't really super. Reed,
Cameron Diaz. Oh, jeez.
Yeah, that's unfortunate.
Why do we have to put Cameron Diaz in everything?
Because they have very little imagination.
Chu as Kato.
Yeah, and I saw him at Comic-Con.
What else has he done?
I'm not excited about this movie.
You're going to go see it with me, though, right?
I don't know.
What if it's at our theater?
You know, here's the thing.
It probably won't be at our theater.
Can I tell you, if I'm disappointed, I'm going to trash the place.
There will be blood.
You cannot trash our theater.
I mean, this is like the one, like, if you mess with this, the Green Hornet, because I grew up on that.
Pitchforks and torches.
Van Williams. That's pretty much what I think. His name was Van Williams and Kato, played by, come on, Bruce Lee? Excuse me?
Yeah, there's not awesome. Going to be much you can do to top that.
No.
You can't. And they had an awesome car.
They did. Yeah. A fabulous car.
Right.
And there's an episode where...
She's never seen it.
I know, but I'm just going to tell you this. You remember Batman with Adam West?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So those two shows, they brought on the Green Hornet with the success of Batman with Adam West. Mm-hmm. And there was a crossover episode with the Green Hornet and Batman. And at the end of it, Batman thought the Green Hornet was a vigilante. Now go figure that. That's how badass Green Hornet was.
Yeah.
If Batman's calling you, I don't like that guy, I think he's a vigilante, you know something's up.
You need to dial it down.
Yeah, exactly. I just remember as a kid, I'd watch a show, and they just burst into some bad guy's apartment, some gangster or something, and just start beating on him. And I was like, okay, this is fantastic. My kind of guy, man. Yeah. He's taking care of evil.
Eliminate the middleman.
Exactly. And Bruce Lee with his stars and his, you know, Kato moves and stuff. It was awesome.
I'll just watch Game of Death a couple more times.
Yeah.
Oof. I'll just watch it some more.
All right, I'm sorry, Dr. Marvel.
I had to digress there. We're talking all geeky comic and stuff, and I had to talk about on Halloween, my favorite.
Actually, quote, I should superhero. Say what Dr. Normal and I were planning to do for Halloween this year. And that we just didn't have the time to pull it off. We could try it next year, but the movie will have come out. And Dr. Norrell was going to be the Green Hornet, and I was going to be Kato.
Oh.
Yeah. Yeah. And pretty much my costume.
I think you can try it though.
My costume.
I know.
I've got a costume.
Yeah, again, yeah,
thing
you're
I've got my thing that I got to do.
The problem is dying all the shit green.
Yeah, with him, he's the problem. Mm. I've got the Kato thing down. All I need is a little chauffeur's cap. Not a big deal.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, you need lots and lots of writ.
Yeah, and we just don't have the time for that. And the hat, it's hard to match. So.
Yeah.
Because we are now in the new 30-minute after hours format.
Right. We're working on that.
Which, are we already past it?
Probably. Well, you know, we're working on it.
But we're working on it, and we're making an effort to make after hours more consumable. We are going to wind down, and I'm going to ask Jemiah how she feels about the fact that essentially a 12-year-old boy is taking over Dr. Normal. Doctor Who? Dr. Normal.
The 12-year-old Normal boy is taking over Dr. Normal, too. No, I mean, really.
He is a 12-year-old boy. It's okay.
everyone else. Oh, Matthew Smith.
He's like a little tiny baby.
He's cute, though.
He's a little baby child. How can he be the Doctor Who? How can he be the Doctor?
The Doctor can be anything.
He's a baby. I'm not sure how I feel.
That's true.
Of course, doctor could be, I was very, doctor very... Could be
no, baby. I mean, I felt, oddly enough, I felt that about Peter Davison, that he was just too young to play the Doctor, but I'm in love with him, so what are you going to do?
Young. I'm upset.
You're not that young.
I'm upset every time. Every time a doctor changes, I get upset.
Yeah, me too. Because sometimes I don't like him, because I don't like Colin Baker at all. I don't like Colin Baker. I think he sucked. He had a great companion, but I don't like him.
When just in the modern series, when Christopher Eccleston left,
I was heartbroken. I'm sitting there watching the DVDs, and I'm just like, no.
And you know David Tennant's coming.
No.
But still. No.
Christopher Eccleston does nothing but break hearts. That's his whole career. He swoops in, he
and
makes you fall in love with him, and then he leaves.
He did in Heroes
never 2. To return.
Heroes 2?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
We still hold out hope for him every week. Every time we're just
I'm always like
a puppy sitting at the door going,
come on, you could be anywhere. You could be anywhere.
Back.
Come on, you could be anywhere.
Coming back. No. No, if we're lucky, he shows up in the web comics. No, that's not good enough.
No.
And the thing about it is he left the show to do that incredibly terrible movie. And then another incredibly terrible movie. And then another incredibly terrible movie.
Good TV.
What's his deal?
Bad movies.
What's his deal?
Good TV, bad movies.
He was in so many good movies before.
How do you really feel?
Just, I resent him. I'm very upset with him.
I don't like it. I don't like being disappointed.
No. But yeah, he was a wonderful,
Ruby doesn't
wonderful
like being
doctor.
Disappointed.
I give him credit, though. They really revived that series really well.
Yeah.
I mean, that got me going.
But the Doctor?
Oh, yeah.
That's the one
that
he'll watch Doctor
Absolutely.
Who. He'll watch Doctor Who, and that says a lot.
I watch Doctor Who with
I love the show kind of no matter what, but, like, not the way that I love it now.
Yeah.
Really? You know, I've watched it since I was a little kid.
You didn't like the guy with the scarf, Baker? You didn't like him
at all? He's fine.
Okay.
I'm not romantically attached to him, though, like most, you know, Doctor Who fans my age are. Because
he just had such a...
Yeah, he's
he was
great,
a great actor.
But he's very, you know...
You know what?
It's great, but it's very kind of, you know, I'm not...
Well, he wasn't sexy, but that
really...
wasn't the point.
You know what?
No, he doesn't
you don't have to be sexy
not...
to be sexy.
Because Sylvester
as the
McCoy wasn't sexy either, but I loved him as a Doctor, and the episodes that he was on were really great, because they were really dark and spooky, and I enjoyed them. And I liked his companion, too. And then, you know, the show went off. And then, you know, later comes back with Eccleston. I'm just like, yay, right on. And I watched it and was like, wow.
What's your favorite?
Oh, man.
What's your favorite episode of this series, the later series, the now series? Either Doctor. I can only ask this because I actually know my favorite
what
episode.
What is the name of that episode? And that sort of episode arc. It's got child in the title. The what child? The something child. The hollow child. The empty child. That episode freaked me out.
Yeah.
I'm an adult watching it on
that
TV.
That scared the crap out of me.
But I have this thing about gas masks.
That thing scared me.
And, you know, but just, it was, and I was like, this is what Doctor Who is. Just so distilled of just like that feeling of creeping dread done on this tiny, tiny budget.
That is so cool.
And it was super
aren't
freaky.
Gas masks one of the most creepiest
things? They are the
thing.
Creepiest thing ever.
I mean, like, if you want to scare
that's
the crap
Pink
out
Floyd
of somebody. That's
why Pink Floyd scared me for the first, like,
Pink
20
Floyd.
Years of my life.
Yeah, exactly.
And it's taken me a long time to become a fan of Pink Floyd
because of the gas masks.
Great example. Great example. Pink Floyd.
My favorite
the wall
episode.
Traumatized me very, 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 very badly.
I was
far too young to see that.
I was in Copenhagen.
It was
and actually have this on video. There was a modern art. It was in this. There's like this middle age thing in the middle of Copenhagen, like a middle age tower mm-hmm. or something that's right. like in the middle of
medieval.
Oh, and middle ages, not whatever. Middle age.
Yeah, yeah.
And like middle age. But like there was this. They're all 50.
They're all wearing Crocs and Sam's belts. Reading so AARP magazine.
Sorry, hun.
There was an art exhibit there.
Okay.
And there, and I have this on video. I videotaped this. It was awesome. It was like, and a whole bunch of like post-apocalyptic people in gas masks and just cool, really cool art. I mean, like really disturbing, but. You know when you see something disturbing like Giger or something, and it's mm-hmm. like, that's so disturbing, it's really cool.
Yeah, and then there's the stuff that's so disturbing, you're just like...
yeah, exactly.
And I was like,
exactly.
And, you know, but, I watch movies, and, you know, I cheered decapitations, and I love Ooh. Gore, and I love splatter. Mm-hmm. Gas masks will freak me out and give me nightmares. Yeah. I love gore. I love cinematic violence because I'm really interested in movie special effects.
Did you ever see David Lynch's Dune?
Oh my goodness, yes. I know it by heart.
Great,
in fact,
great
by heart.
Do the thing about you'll spend the the thing where the guild navigators come in and talk to the emperor. The guy with the thing sticking out of his head.
Uh huh. Oh. Okay.
You'll spend your life in a pain, an amplifier, and then they walk out. I've always wanted to do that in a meeting.
Oh,
we were not here.
But Paul and Shawnee's love grew. I mean, really.
You will spend your life in a pain, amplifier.
St. Ollie of the Night.
Thank you.
I'm telling you. Very good. Very good.
Lovely, Dr. Normal.
I'm impressed.
And on that note.
That was my entree to the works of Dean Stockwell.
Oh
Dean.
My word.
I know.
What a fantastic.
And I have loved him ever since.
Blue Velvet? I'm sorry.
And so, I watched Dune and was just like, I love this David Lynch guy. Yeah. Hey, he's got this movie, Blue Velvet, that's coming on next, you know, on Cinemax or whatever in the 80s. And I watched it and it warped me permanently, instantly. And I was just like, I love this more than anything.
I'm no longer
I'm not
same
freaked out.
I
no,
was.
I love this more than anything. This is what I want.
Okay.
Sorry.
Every time I have to say though,
I need to
where's
go watch
my
some...
bourbon?
We have gone over
Blue Ribbon,
Dr. Normal,
Heineken,
Dr. Normal.
I'm sorry,
Dr. Jemiah. We have gone over our time allotment. We must say goodbye to the children.
Have we covered everything?
No. Jemiah's gonna have to come back.
Yeah, I'll come back again.
Yeah, she's gonna have to come back.
And... we'll have another chin wag. Well, I'll come back and let's have a show about TV.
I think that would be awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, let's come back and watch. Or let's have a show about Dune.
Ooh.
Let's have a show about the works of David Lynch, focusing on Dune.
Bring Brahm on.
We would. We Brahm would have to bring like Brahm big... on for the...
Do we have to do the Rock'em Sock'em Robots?
Dune game.
Yeah.
I have that's... Dune gummy worms.
What?
Nice.
In my office.
Dune
gummy worms.
Okay.
I swear to God.
We're going to say goodbye. We're going to wrap this up. Jemiah.com, Jemiah J on Twitter. Do you have a blog? You don't have a, why don't you have
I
a blog?
I do. I have three different live journals. They're slightly more personal than I really feel like making like widely available, but it's incredibly easy to find me if you want to do
that. If you really wanted to stalk her.
It's really not that hard to find me.
All right. Dr. Normal, say goodnight to the people. Say happy Halloween.
Good night, people.
That's his way of saying happy Halloween. Be safe. Have fun.
Are you a human or are you an animal?
Don't eat all my candy.
I can go all night, you know.
Jemiah, thank you so much for joining us. We're
going
to bring
you
back.
Much.
I might have a venue for you to say things all night. We'll talk about that.
Awesome.
Are our microphones off yet, Dr. Normal?
Not yet.
I love that.
Excellent. You're good.
Yui,
a million deaths are not enough
Ruby.
For Yui.
Good night to Ruby.
He used the voice. Exactly. Happy Halloween.
I will kill him.
Good night.
You know, that's why I watched Dune. That's why I watched Dune, because Sting was in it. That is the reason why I watched the film for the first time.
Don't let Dr. Normal bite or sing Roxanne. To you anymore. No. He's going to give you nightmares. Turn it off now. Turn it off now. Turn it off now.
Dr. Normal, no.
Everybody.